ऋषया वेदाः निस्त्रैगुण्यो भवार्जुना निर्द्वन्द्वो नित्यसत्त्वस्थः निर्योगक्षेममात्मवान्।
त्रैगुण्य विषया वेदाः, द वेदास एक्सप्लेन द थ्री गुणास, ट्रेट्स। ओ अर्जुना, free yourself of the three gunas and the pairs of opposites. Establish yourself in sattva, purity, and become atmavan. What an inspiring term it is, just one word. Remain in the self, free from nir yoga kshema, free from acquisitiveness and possessiveness. So what is he saying here? One of the most outstanding contributions to humanity by these ancient Vedic masters is the understanding analysis of human thought into three distinct categories. They are sattva, rajas, tamas. Just as there are three primary colors in the world, and the permutation and combination of these three colors make the infinite variety of colors. Similarly, all of us have just the three gunas, sattva, rajas, tamas. But their permutations and combinations are so different that every one of us is distinct and different from everyone else. It creates an infinite variety of living beings. We have now entered the second last topic, which deals with right action. It's a wonderful, highly inspiring piece. And every one of us can go back recharged, fully charged with the knowledge of what is right action. So he starts by saying here, the guna code is purity, sattva, passion, rajas, apathy, tamas. We see that in us. There are times when you are extremely lethargic. You don't want to do anything. And even if someone else suggests activity, you get irritated, angry. Example, tomorrow morning, on a Sunday morning, if someone says, why don't you do this for me? You say, get out of here. You get irritated, lethargy, apathy. Then Monday morning comes and you're all keyed up for action. But it is desire driven. It's full of passion. It is full of selfishness. And so even though you are acting, it has negative repercussions, which is stress, inability to enjoy the fruits of your endeavors, inability to act properly. All this happens with rajas. And sattva is that pure moment in your life when you are absolutely tranquil. There's nothing you want, there's nothing that you are craving for. It's not sleep, because your intellect is alert, alive, awake, and you're brimming with ideas, creativity. Particularly if you are in a creative field, if you're a writer or artist, you will find that it's, or a sports person for that matter, any field. It's only when your mind is calm that your thinking is alert, you're creative, and action's brilliant. It just flows. Have you experienced that? There are times when effortlessly you're able to come up with excellent actions. Just in a matter of a few minutes, you finish the whole day's work. So that is sattva. Now the three gunas are explained in different ways. And those of you who are interested in the details, there is an entire CD, a 60-minute exposition on just these three gunas. It's called the guna code, right? Yeah. So the three gunas, shortly, just briefly, is tamas is the state of ignorance. When your vasanas, your desires are in an unmanifest state, and extreme tamas is deep sleep. Rajas is when your desires, when you wake up, your desires start manifesting And these desires manifest from a state of restlessness, emptiness, lack of self-sufficiency. And you go rushing out into the world to acquire objects and beings to fulfill this restlessness. This is called, so therefore you are constantly in a state of agitation. You see people like that in our city, in Mumbai city, there is a great deal of dynamism, but a great deal of rajas. And at the drop of a hat, you're willing to pick up a fight with anybody. That's rajas. So you see rickshawala and a taxi driver fighting with each other. You see people fighting in trains for space. You find people fighting in offices, arguing with each other. A typical quality of rajas is not accepting that you are at fault. A tamasic person also does not accept, but a tamasic person is not even aware. A rajasic person is aware, but he quickly passes the blame on to somebody else. A sattvic person is in a state of serenity because he is in contemplation of the higher. The moment you inject the thought of the higher into your personality, your entire personality develops a sattvic flavor. So how much of sattva do you need? Just a little. That little bit of sattva is enough to subdue your personality. And that's what is lacking today. So what he's saying here is, you need to, he says, the Vedas explain the three gunas. As long as you are caught up with the three gunas, you will remain in the world. So the objective is to become nistre, rise above the three gunas. And how do you rise above the three gunas? Just eradicate tamas and rajas and establish yourself in sattva. That's what he's saying here. Once you are 100% sattva, you cannot exist as a human being, because in order to be a living being, you need all three. The moment you eradicate tamas and rajas, you get catapulted, you get pushed into the state of enlightenment or realization. And this is the mission and purpose of our life here. Then you become liberated from the dvandvas. So he says, nirdvandvaha. What is happening with us is the world is full of pairs of opposites. You and I are full of likes and dislikes. So there is a constant conflict, constant clash between your likes and dislikes and the pairs of opposites in the world. This is what creates agitation, stress. So there are times when you're jumping with joy because your like is met with. There are times when you sink with sorrow because the world doesn't cater to you. You can't change the world. The world is what it is. But you can rise above your likes and dislikes. It is like in Mumbai, you see, there is an intersection and there's so much traffic and so much congestion, and suddenly a flyover comes. Huh? So the flyover just rises above all the congestion. It's like the JJ flyover. In a matter of a few minutes, you cover a distance which otherwise would take you perhaps 45 minutes. At times impossible. So you have to establish your own flyovers, mental flyovers. So the likes and dislikes go under, all the congestion is underneath, and you just take off into, and this can happen only when you are established in sattva. Otherwise, as long as you're riding on your likes and dislikes, your world shrinks to just what you like and what you dislike. Have you seen people, they say, oh, I don't go beyond my area. People in Juhu will say, I'm self-sufficient in Juhu, I don't go beyond. I'm not asking you to go anywhere. We are not saying you should go, but you get restricted because of your likes and dislikes. You say, oh, I can only travel where there is Indian food. Or I don't like cold places. I like this and I don't like that. So your entire world shrinks and you can operate only within a certain... You are living in a prison of your own making. Please understand that. And then at the emotional level, I like such people. I dislike certain other people. Life is the ability to get on with people of different kinds. You can't get stuck with one kind of person. So that's it. And even if you get everything that you like, if your mind is agitated, you can't enjoy it. That's why Vedantic masters say, you might get married to the best person in the world, but you can still be miserable. You can get, by the same token, you can get married to the worst specimen of humanity, you can be happy with him. And this is the capacity that the Bhagavad Gita Vedanta gives us. So thereafter, you're independent. Then comes the other obsession we have. Acquisition, acquisitiveness, not acquisition, and possessiveness. Even when your people come here to the Bhagavad Gita lectures, I've heard people say, did you see the diamonds that so-and-so was wearing? Are you? Have you come to listen to the Gita or have you come to analyze whether people are wearing diamonds or pearls? It's immaterial. A person who comes for knowledge doesn't even notice any of this. Not because the vision is bad, because the mind is just focused. So acquisitiveness. You go around looking at what others have and you don't have. You conveniently forget what you have and others don't have. Acquisitiveness. There, the first time I went to Dubai, we stayed in the home of a family where the lady in her kitchen had any and every gadget that has been produced in the world. But all packed in boxes. Not opened. And what she was using was an old mixer manufactured in India. So we asked her, so why do you buy all these things if you don't? No, sometime I will use it. Acquisitiveness and possessiveness. So what you don't have, you want to acquire. What you have, you are possessive about. You don't want anybody to touch anything. You don't want your family members to go outside your area of interest. So there are people who, in Delhi, the husband has interest in classical music, the wife wants only Bollywood. So he can't go to a classical music program. Why? Possessiveness. You can't do what I have no interest in. Are? So have you married a person or have you entered a jail is the question. Possessiveness. And you must understand what happens. The moment you get possessive about someone, that person who otherwise would be very loving towards you now develops a disgust for you. Revulsion. Repulsion. Can't stand the other person just because of possessiveness. Because remember one thing, we are born free. And freedom is the one thing that we cherish. If somebody else takes away that freedom, he may give you anything. You don't want it. You'd rather be hungry and free than be in luxury in a prison. So that's what it is. The more acquisitive and possessive you are, the more you lose what you have. So now why is this acquisitiveness and possessiveness there? Because of a lack of self-sufficiency. You are not complete within yourself, so you need to hang on to so many things. And that insecurity is there because I need you. If you go away, what happens to me? Why should you be insecure? You've got everything in the world. You have yourself. You can stand on your own feet. You have your personality. Be happy with yourself. To establish a relationship because you are insecure is the worst thing that you can do. But once you become totally self-sufficient, then you can have thousands of relationships, you'll be fine, like Krishna. Krishna says openly in the Gita, he tells Arjuna, there is nothing in the three worlds that I haven't obtained that I need to obtain. Yet I continue to act, Arjuna. Yet I relate with the world. yet I spread joy and cheer everywhere, which is true. And that's how you should be. Next verse.